Rukmini, I don't know if Loga was involved, and it was really a great honor and privilege for me. I hope they have not made a bad choice, but I believe there are at least three people who can do this job equally well. Anyway, let me begin by just saying that I am going to give you an overview. So everybody else has talked about one paper. I'm going to talk about 15 papers. Thank you. So I'll be talking about, she had about 45 papers in all. There may be some more. We really, one of them I think has not been published. One was published posthumously. So about 45 papers. She, those days they never wrote with their students. She had about 16 students, so that would have added 16 more papers, if you wish. And I will talk about 8 or 9 of them, which are her principal works. I cannot talk about everything. And some of the topics are covered in 3 papers or so, so that way it'll add to the number. Okay, so I give you an overview of her contribution to modern algebra. And modern is to indicate that the algebra which started with her is called modern algebra. Earlier it was algebra. And also her influence on present day research. So I'm going to have a different type of role. This, of course, was already told to you by Loga about the name, that the name was changed to Noether. How many of you know who is Bhim Rao Sakpal? How many know who is Bhim Rao Sakpal? No? Bala Sahib Ambedkar. Okay, his real name was that. So I don't know. This, of course, Loga was explaining something which was slightly different, why the name was changed. Okay. So we just had some idea about Felix Klein's influence. He brought world fame to Erlangen by talking about the Klein program, the Erlangen program as it is called, which took the concept of a group in geometry. And his colleague was Noether's guide, Paul Gordon, as well as Max Noether, her father. And it is possibly due to that Gordon, at the age of 61, agreed to take Noether, a female, as his student. She was very lucky that it was just a year before, in 1904, that Erlangen decided that a woman can register for a PhD program. Okay? Gordon did not have any other students. At the age of 61, he has taken his first female student. Though he was an extremely well-known mathematician and who has done some very good work of his own. So she finished her doctorate in 3 years' time. No BA or MA in math. Okay, that did not matter. And the topic of her thesis, I will not exactly say it now, but it was in the subject of computational classical invariant theory. In her thesis, in the end, you can see a bunch of formulae which she has written down on the invariance of ternary biquadratic forms. So I'll talk a little bit about this later. And of course, her thesis was awarded the highest distinction possible. So her thesis appeared in Rheine and Argument Mathematics, which is one of the top journals. It's about 67 pages long, 68 pages long. But like it was pointed out earlier, she herself referred to her thesis as crap and said it was a jungle of formulas, routine calculations. However, I have my serious doubts about it, and I talked to my friends in computational algebra, and they are also looking at both the works of Gordon and Noether. I'll tell you a little bit more about that when I come to that. So she continued to be in Erlangen, unpaid, as a lecturer after her thesis, and began to study the work of Hilbert, who had already started shaking the world of invariant theory. So luckily for her, Hilbert had 2 students, Fischer and Schmidt, who were successors of Gordon when he retired in 1910. And it was Fischer's influence, and Noether acknowledges it in the papers, that Emmy Noether made the change from purely computational methods, which are distinctly algorithmic, to the mode of thinking of Hilbert. Okay? It was just not Hilbert's paper, but also Fisher's influence. And I will talk about the particular influence which Fisher had on her a little later. She also was discussing with, by exchanging letters with Hilbert and Klein. Klein is the senior person, by the way. And Hilbert, Klein was almost 65 plus at that time. Hilbert was younger, his successor. And it was Klein who convinced Hilbert that we should invite her to come to Göttingen. And this was, Hilbert had also once gone on a tour of 22 cities in Germany, and he had spotted her at that time. And he had also realized, of course, her type of work was so different that he was not quite sure. And he was hesitating, actually, because Hilbert had become interested in physics. For almost 15 years, he had become interested in physics. And he was not quite sure whether she would fit in, but Klein explained and convinced him. But when he tried to make her come there, he found a lot of opposition, as has been told before. So he did not manage to convince the humanities that it is possible to give her a job. They said she will become a professor afterwards, all that, how can anybody work with such a situation? So he did not manage. So Noether herself was so eager that she decided, okay, I come without pay. It's not that she was from a rich family. Her father was only an academician. But she was also supported very much by her father. Her father had very strong conviction. He was a mathematician. He recognized her talents in the school days itself, and he pushed her to do mathematics. And she was very capable. He realized that. So he continued to support her financially. Her mother had passed away just before she went from Erlangen to Göttingen. And she gave lectures as Professor Hilbert, the title, and it was her lecture. So she was paid a small amount for those lectures. Then she got an appointment as honorary professor a little later. And due to that was Courant, who was the director. And he made sure that she got a what they call Lehrauf Virag, which is not a salary actually, but small salary you can say, of 200 to 400 marks, which is a good amount those days. And she gave lectures, according to that she got the exact figure, but this had to be confirmed every year to be able to give her that amount. Then her guardian passed away. Her brother Fritz, also a mathematician, he went away to the military. Fisher went to the military, and her mother died. So she sort of moved at that time at the invitation of Klein and Hilbert to become a privat docent, which means she could teach but would not get a salary. You have been in this conference learning a lot about her work on physics. I am not going to mention about the work on physics. I am not going to mention about the work on topology, because Indranil has already given you an idea of how she influenced that. Originally, I thought I would only talk about that. And I'm going to talk very little, if I have the time, on the work which Professor Kanduja talked about. That's one of her important theorems. So I might say a little bit about that. But basically, the work of Noether is remembered by the Noetherian property, which he isolated. The so-called ascending chain condition for ideals. You have a sequence of ideals, one contained in the other. In those rings where they must stop after a certain stage, these are called the Noetherian rings today. Because she isolated that this property is so powerful, it can do much. Okay? There's a Noetherian group, Noetherian induction. There's Noether normalization, which I will talk about. There's Noether problem, which I will talk about. Then she also introduced modules. Schemes came afterwards, but it is also they are called Noetherian schemes because they are the schemes which are easier to sort of deal with. Then you have the Albert Brauer Hasse Noether theorem. You have the Lasker Noether theorem and the Skolem Noether theorem. So these are some of the most important theorems which are named after her. Okay. She basically established mathematical rings. Then she had the idea what is the right definition for a commutative ring, and the entire basis of commutative ring theory as studied today is due to her and Krull, but started completely on her work. And she also did things in non-commutative ring theory, which I hope I'll have some time to talk about, because she did quite a lot of important work there. So basically, her idea there, since I may not have much time later, is just that people were working with matrices. And she did not want to work with matrices. I work with matrices, just imagine. Okay? She works with matrices, many of us do. She changed the idea to what Indranil called module. She changed that you should think of modules and you should think of actions on modules. So the whole change of way of thinking enabled her to connect very different types of topics, which we will come to. Okay? And then she had a great idea that these non-commutative algebras would be useful in the study of number fields, commutative rings. Okay? And specifics about them. So this was the first important paper which might have taken her away from invariant theory. Invariant theory was her bread and butter before that. And this was the paper which appeared, a 134-page paper in 1910 by Steinitz. Okay, and Steinitz's paper was about field theory. He established about fields, all the things in an axiomatic manner. Various property of fields on the basis of axioms. So he wrote down, this is a field, if and only if, so and so, axioms are satisfied, and then what does that lead to? Okay? And this Noether really liked. And even at that time, she had thought, I should do something similar for more general structures. At that time, the concept of a ring was not there. But she already in her mind knew that there were other objects which were being studied, especially like by Dedekind and number fields and number rings. And those objects should also be covered by this type of axiomatic treatment. So this was one of the main works which affected her way of thinking and took her away from invariant theory. So let me tell you a little bit about invariant theory. Though I will not be able to precisely tell you what Noether's thesis does. I will tell you vaguely. I cannot tell you very precisely because there are some definitions which are a bit more involved than I would like to say. So what are the normal things you think about? The first realization is that the three fundamental contributions of Hilbert in algebra, note that Hilbert was not just an algebraist, he did lots of other things, Hilbert space, you know, various things. So he had three important theorems, the Null-Sullensatz, which we will talk about, the basis theorem, which is just that in a polynomial ring, if you take a so-called ideal, the word ideal was not there, then it is finitely generated. Okay? And this was somewhat path-breaking because his way of thinking was not to produce a basis, but to say it exists. And it was not appreciated as proper mathematics for quite some time. Till 3 years later when he gave a different way of doing it also. Then he had his CCG theorem, which might be saying the birth of homological algebra, started with that. So there are three papers came in 1890 and 1893 in this period. And here is the example which Hilbert was considering about a polynomial in n variables or the complex numbers. You call it symmetric if it is invariant under the permutations, Sn, the permutations on the n variables. That means f of x1, xn must be equal to f of sigma 1, x sigma n, for every sigma in Sn. So you take example, take x1 plus x2 plus xn. This is invariant clearly by any permutation. Same way you can take product two at a time, three at a time, add them up, and all n. So these are the basic invariants. Okay? They are called the elementary symmetric polynomials. And every symmetric polynomial can be written as a polynomial in these symmetric elementary symmetric polynomials. This was known long back, even to Newton, probably. okay? And therefore, there is no relationship between these symmetric, elementary symmetric polynomials. Those relations are usually called syzygy. Now, you can do the same thing by taking, instead of the SN, take any group, take any subgroup of a linear group, that is a subgroup of GLNC. And you can again act on the variables by the action of that matrix. So the column x1, xn goes to the matrix times x1, xn. For example, if you take x1 square plus 2x1, x2, and you take the matrix to be 0, 1, minus 1, 0, and x1 goes to x2, and x2 goes to minus x1, and f will go to x2 square minus 2x1, x2, so it's not an invariant. And you can ask, what are the elements in the ring which are invariant under the action of this group? That is denoted by Cx1 xn to the power g. All the elements which are invariant actually turns out to be a ring. One can add these things and you can multiply these things and they still are in the same ring. So the relevant questions about these rings was, is this ring finitely generated by a finite set of generators? And what are the relations? So is it an algebra over C? That means you can write it as Cx1, xn modulo some ideal. And what are the generators of these ideals? And can you do it in a computational manner? That is, if I give it to a computer, can it tell me the answer? So these were the three questions which were sort of pursued. And Hilbert himself showed that if you have a finite group, then the ring of invariants has transcendence degree n and is finitely generated. So it's an affine algebra of degree, of transcendence degree n. So it's sort of quotient field has is like maybe an algebraic extension of degree n quotient Cx1 xn, the quotient field of Cx1 xn. Nagata, much later in 1959, gave examples to show that for certain exotic linear groups, we need not have finitely generated invariant rings. And this was the sixth problem which Hilbert had posed in his 1900 ICM talk, in which he had posed several problems. And this was the sixth problem which Hilbert had posed about whether such rings are finitely generated. I begin with the last theorem, which Noether proved, which gave an efficient version of Hilbert's theorem. Okay. This is called a Noether's degree bound. So what Noether did was, the invariant ring has of a finite matrix group, linear group, has a basis of at most so many invariants, and whose degrees are bounded. Now this immediately means that if I tell a computer, go up to so much and check, then it can do it. Of course, I'm being simplistic. As I will tell you a little later, the story developed a little more slowly. But this certainly made the computational people feel that one can actually compute all these rings, and they were useful to know these rings. Second thing was that Noether had an assumption that she did not necessarily work over complex numbers. She also worked over any field. In that case, she had to assume that the order of the group was invertible in that field. So then the question comes, what happens if it is not invertible? That's called modular invariant theory. Okay. So that was a topic which also developed and is still quite active these days. So let me go to the thesis now and tell you a bit about invariant theory first. Started in 1841 by Boole, the same Boolean algebra Boole. But he didn't do much. But he was successful in attracting the attention of Cayley, who interested Sylvester, and then Salmon came from Cambridge. And these three worked on invariants so much that they were called the invariant trinity by Herbert. So many nice invariants were found by them. And we all enjoyed that period, actually. The discriminant, Hessian, Jacobian, Hilton, catalecticant. I don't know if you heard that. Heard that? That's about the circulant. Take the determinant of the circulant. x1, x2, xn, x2, x1, x3, xn, 1, like that. Take the determinant of that. That's another invariant called a catalytic current. So the main problem at that time was to find invariants and to find out whether they were complete systems. So Cayley was able to show that the ones found by Eisenstein, who is a student of Gauss, or the binary cubic form, ones obtained by him for the binary quartic form. So binary, the first word is always the number of variables, and the second word is the degree. So binary quartic means two variables, degree four, okay? Now, here I am not explaining to you what do you mean by the invariants of the binary quartic form. What do you mean by invariants of a form, okay? So there is a specific definition, and one has to bring in covariance and all those things, and so I didn't get into it. But I can only say the following. Today, we think of it in a different way. We just think of, take the ideal, which is generated by all of them, find set of generators which are of that type. There are a finite set of generators, and if there is a finite set of generators, because these are homogeneous of a given order, you can always find generators of those types. So find a set of generators of that type, and tell us that these are going to give all of them. So that is the idea, and they did it for various type of forms. A basis for binary forms of any given degree was given by Paul Gordon. He used some geometric ideas of Clebsch, okay? He also showed it algorithmically, how to get them. He also later on worked it out for ternary quadratic forms, ternary cubic forms. And then he started the idea of taking two forms, three forms. Sort of the idea of the ideal also developed slowly like that. Kung and Rota in 1984, they tried to understand, is Gordon done the job properly? They found it impossible. By this time, computer algebra has developed quite a lot. So it just shows that how difficult it was even to do that. In fact, they started a new method, which is more popular these days, called the symbolic calculus. But they record that Gordon's method is the most effective one. Okay? And they also say that his brackets of brackets method, it will really need a deep understanding of the straightening law, which they had written down. So Hilbert also wrote his thesis on invariant theory. Then he reproved, of course, he was a student of a number theorist, so I don't know how he did invariant theory. Anyway, he reproved Gordon's binary form theorem by some method using an argument of Mertens, which was like an inductive method. And then he found that he had a completely different proof in 1888. This was completely existential. So obviously everybody then got upset. Gordon said that this is not mathematics, it's theology. But this is where the thinking of Noether must have developed from. Noether is famous for an incisive thinking of taking an abstract concept and using it. And this is the first step which Hilbert started. He started this thinking process that you don't really do everything by hand. That was the Indian method, to do it by hand. The Indian method was even better. They only gave the answer. They never said how they got it. The algorithm was never written. In fact, that is the reason they didn't get credit for many things which they did. They thought it was obvious. Once you give an answer, what more do you want? But Hilbert was sensitive to the criticism of Gordon, and within 3 years, he gave a different proof. This is called a constructive proof. So it is not exactly an algorithmic way which a computer can use. It's called the null code method. But people have worked on it, and present day people like Strumpfels have really managed to make it more algorithmic. And he used what is called the Cayley omega process. So this approach could be made algorithmic, but it was not done at that time. But Gordon did it for certain things. Okay, and what Gordon scribbled turned out to be useful to get the way the computer gets the generators, the so-called Gromner basis. This idea came from Gordon's calculations. Gromner saw it, he worked out something, but then he asked his student to work it out, Buchberger. And Buchberger worked it out and named it after his guide. Such a nice thing. How many students would name it after their guide? Something so fundamental which they discovered. And this is really the basic reason why today we can do computational algebra with a computer. So she worked on the, you can see now, ternary biquadratic form. Three variables, degree four, and two of them. So that was something quite huge. And must have really tired her out. She wrote 331 formulas. She herself says they are crap, but I'm not sure. I asked my people in computational algebra, they are afraid to do it because they have seen that Rota has failed with the binary form. And Rota was a very strong mathematician, and he has failed with the binary form. So they are really afraid to do it. But there are some ways to do it and check it, and I'm hoping to interest them to actually check it out carefully. Nobody has really checked out whether the thing is complete. That is, she has found all the invariants and whether they be a complete set. So she studied invariant theory after her thesis was over. And from 1911 to 1919, that means part time in Erlangen and part in Göttingen. She did it for various cases using Hilbert's techniques and her own. But when she tried to do the ternary quartic, she found it quite impossible. And that is the reason she really quit invariant theory. Hilbert, as you know, was busy with physics. So he didn't have much liking for invariant theory at that time. So here is the first problem she did, which was outside invariant theory in Erlangen. Okay? She's quite famous for this work. It's very simple. I can, in fact, explain it to you fully. I'll try to do that. The question is the following. Suppose you have got a finite group, G. Is it the group of automorphism of some field L over K, which fixes K? That's called the Galois group. Is it the Galois group of some extension L of Q? Q is the rationals. Yeah, that is important. It can always be made Galois or two different fields. Okay, but to make it for Q was the really hard thing. And some results which were known were the Kronecker-Weber, which was known for finite abelian groups. Okay, and they also saw that cyclotomic fields, that is, once extended by the primitive roots of identity, could be used. Then there was the Hilbert irreducibility theorem, which said that if you take a polynomial over a function field in one variable, which is irreducible, then you can specialize at infinitely many points in Q, such that the polynomial ft not x, which is the polynomial got by specializing, is irreducible over qx. There is something strange. Okay, it doesn't happen. You specialize, and irreducible doesn't remain irreducible. But if you, Hilbert showed that you can do it for infinitely many points. And using that, he showed that Sn and An, the even permutation, can be realized as Galois groups. Fisher had also done something. And her work on that started with discussions with Fisher. So Fisher had shown that if you take a finite abelian group of exponent E, that means all the orders divide E of the elements of the group, and you take a field whose of characteristic which is prime to P and contains the Eth roots of unity, then if you take the fixed, the KVG is what I have written, is just KX1 XN G, if V is of dimension N. Okay, you just think of X1 XN and G acting on the variables X1 XN by means of a linear action. Then he proved that this is rational over K. This is actually the first example that what Emmy Noether was going to think about. He gave an example. He didn't talk about the inverse Galois problem, but he talked about this. Now you'll see characteristic of her. So what is the action? If you take a finite group, then you can say that XH goes to XGH, or all H in G. So here it is not a linear action, sorry. This is the action by left translation. So he took the left translation. And he used this. So Emmy Noether caught on this. That is a characteristic of her. She caught on this, and she caught on the Hilbert irreducibility theorem. So she proves the following. She says, if QXG is rational, that is purely transcendental, then you can get G as a Galois group over Q. So she finished the problem, which Fisher had started. Let me tell you her proof. And tell her, it gives you a great idea about how she thinks. So she would only say the following. Given the group, find the matrix. Find the equation, sorry. And given the equation, find the group. In 1 minute, she completely, all your theory of Galois theory, all that thing is forgotten. It becomes very precise. And this is what she did later on also when she worked with that Hasse-Brauer theorem. There also, I'll say the same thing. That's what she did. She used to tell clearly, incisive, a statement, but then anybody can really think about it. So here's how she thought about it. So if the fixed field is a rational function field, so they say it is Q, W1, Wn, then you have got a primitive element theorem which says that the Qx will be a generated by a single element, okay? And so if you take the irreducible polynomial of theta, which is a polynomial in Q, W1, Wn, T, okay, that's the minimal polynomial theta. So Qx over Qxg is Galois with group G, and this is a polynomial Ft which has the Galois group G. But now it is over Qxg. Now you want to make it over Q. So you specialize. That's what Hilbert said. If you specialize enough, there are enough number of elements that you can get an irreducible polynomial. You need an irreducible polynomial to ensure that the degree will remain n. And because Ft has Galois group G, one can see that the specialized polynomial also has Galois group G. So simple, okay? So she gave the idea of parametrizing all Galois extension with a given group G. If you have that it's a function field is of the invariants is a rational, then you can get a generic Galois extension for K and G. You can parameterize. And this idea has been used very much in the 1987 work of David Saltman, and it's called the generic freeness method today, okay? So you can now say Noether's problem is find all G for which Qx1, Xn, G is rational over Q. This becomes a problem in geometry, okay? So Richard Swan showed that it's not always true. And his example was a cyclic group of order 47. That was the least example. Lenstra later on showed it's possible for a group of order 8 or for any group which contains an abelian group of order 8. Any abelian group which contains an element of order 8. As far as the inverse Galois problem concerned, Shafarovich showed that any solvable group can be realized as a Galois group over Q. This gave him the Fields Medal. There was a problem in the case of groups of order 2 raised to n, but that was later on resolved. And many of the finite simple groups, the Matthew groups of, not all of them, but some of them, then the monster group, this is the biggest finite simple group, was also shown to satisfy the inverse Galois problem. So you can get an extension of that group. So this work is now, I will say, what is the present day status? There are 3 or 4 methods which have evolved. One is Saltman, which basically is the Noether method. Then you have the rigidity method, which is again via Hilbert irreducibility, so inspired by Noether's idea. Because you can always realize over different fields, like Q bar is the algebraic closure of Q. Over such fields, you can always make it a group. But then how to come down to Q? That's a major problem. And that some very nice geometric methods have been evolved by various people. And then you have now the new method of Galois representation by Kare, Larson, and Sevin. It started with ideas of Serre, but Serre never used it in this problem. They started using it in this problem. So 2008, they had a nice result of this type. Now I come to one of our most well-known, what we call lemma, Noether normalization. Have you heard of it? Afterwards, you will find that you have heard of it. Okay? So, in a paper with a strange title, because she was not thinking of the normalization at all, she was thinking of a special case of Hilbert's 14 problem. So Hilbert's 14 problem was that if you have a subfield of the field of rational functions in n variables, then he wanted to know whether the intersection of that subfield with the polynomial ring kx on xn is a finitely generated k algebra. As usual, Nagata comes in the picture and finds a counterexample much later. But Noether had a positive answer for certain types of rings, which were the invariants of a finite group. And for proving that, she used what is known as a Noether normalization. What is Noether normalization? Noether normalization says, if you take an affine ring is a ring which is a polynomial ring, kx on xn modulo an ideal. Okay, these are the rings which appear in geometry. The circle is rxy upon x square plus y square minus 1. Right? So with a geometric object, you have the functions on that space, and that gives you a polynomial ring with some relations. That is the geometric object which people studied at that time. And so the affine ring was a problem, how to study. And she gave a beautiful method. She said that an affine ring will have a good-looking polynomial ring inside it, over which it's a finite module. So you get two new things to exploit when you want to study an affine ring. One is the better ring below, and the other is the finiteness property to enable you to go from the smaller nice properties here to the nice properties here. This has become a very standard technique, which is used in commutative algebra as well as algebraic geometry. I'll give you some instances. Here is the version which is now in use. So you take an affine ring of dimension D or a field K. So dimension you can think of as the number of transcendence variables, which is what actually she proves by using this. And you take a chain of ideals, and you have some condition on their heights. Then you can get a polynomial ring, such that the ring is finitely generated over that polynomial ring. And the ideals become polynomial variables. The ideals become actually polynomial variables. Before I go further, I must say one thing, that this was so inspiring to me that my first paper after my doctorate, I asked myself the question, what about other rings? Are there Noether normalization for other rings? So I was studying local rings, that is, I was studying the ring which is a point on a variety. And look at a point, what is the ring? The ring is the functions divided by those functions which don't vanish on that point. Take all these elements, they form a ring. So that ring I was studying, and I was asking for myself, what is the right Noether normalization for this ring? And there was an object which another German mathematician had come up with. And the extension was not finite, but was ital. So whenever it's finite, you get some ital covering. And then I wanted to know, what is this ideal thing? What is that? That fellow did not mention that. Is it possible to get that ideal business? Something in that range. If I could get that, then I would be solving my problem. So it turns out that with the help of some more geometry, Tarski's main theorem. The literature actually itself gave me that it is possible to do what I was thinking, that the ideal which I have can be made a principal ideal, a variable like that in the polynomial ring. So this led to a proof of a result, which was a conjecture of Quillen. And my colleague and I wrote it up, because my colleague helped me find the literature. And then he gave a different proof in a different way also. And Narasimhan told me, this will be useful in PDEs at that time. I was very surprised. He said some work of some Russian. But when I asked him recently, he said he doesn't remember the name of which Russian mathematician, Shokharov or something. He said something. He has written a book. This will be useful. Now, it turns out that I, of course, forgot all about it. But several years later, Nisnevich, who is known for his topology, used my theorem and wrote a paper on that. And later, Kashiwara wrote a paper in the Annals in which he also used my theorem. And they used it to show that certain PDEs can be diagonalized as diagonal form. They used my theorem on projective modules to show that certain PDEs can be diagonalized. So I understand Nisnevich to a bit. Kashiwara I have not understood much. But I wish somebody would tell me what it is. I'm just saying that just thinking about what Noether has done has been so effective that one should really think. For example, you're in today's physics talk, and you're trying to get more and more supersymmetry and bigger objects. Now, this is what Noether would do. She would wait till enough people have done enough things, and then she will crystallize the whole thing and say, this is what you should be doing. You'll see that, examples of that. She just did that. And it was amazing. Everything which was so complicated before looked very easy. She made it axiomatic. And she was inspired by Steinitz. So let me say a bit. She did not do the ideal version. That was given by Nakata. And geometric statement, if I read out, I'm sure all of you would say, oh, we know this. Okay? Because most people think geometrically. So what it says is, if you have a d-dimensional affine variety and a chain of subvarieties, then you can have a map, a finite map, which takes it to affine space so that all these subvarieties become planes. Is this okay with you? Have you seen something like this? Well, this is something which is more commonly thought of. And the Italians used it all the time. The Italians never bothered about a proof. So this was sort of known to people. But the translation from geometric statements to algebraic statements only came in Hilbert's work and was still fresh. So Noether did not use the translation. She just did it on her own and in fact got Hilbert's theorem as a consequence. So first thing she got was the dimension of the of her affine domain is the transcendence degree of the quotient field. Okay? Then she also got that if you take a chain of maximal prime ideals inside any maximal ideal of the affine domain, then all these chains have the same length. They're unusual. In a ring, it doesn't happen. But in an affine ring, it happens. OK? And then she recovered the null Schlenzarts. The null Schlenzarts is called null Schlenzarts because of null is a single point. So with every maximal ideal, you can associate a point, lambda 1, lambda n. So you see the geometry, a point and an algebra, an ideal, a maximal ideal. So points correspond to maximal ideals. And then there's a stronger form, which says that if you take a prime ideal in an affine domain, it is the intersection of the maximal ideals containing it. So these are two forms which he managed to get. Krull was inspired by her work of that affine domain, and he gave a general definition of Krull dimension for a commutative ring, and he quotes Noether's work in that. He, in fact, doesn't quote Brouwer, who already had a topological definition coming from ideas of Poincaré. And he quotes a work of Rickert also, and analogy with Riemann surfaces. But he was basically inspired by Noether. That was the most recent of the three works. I'll give you some applications, though I won't say too much about it. One is the finiteness of the integral closure. That means if you take a fine domain, which is and then you take the maximal integral extension. Integral is those elements which satisfy a monic polynomial over that subring. Take all the elements there. That also forms a ring. And that is a finite module. So in some sense, it remains within the category of varieties. You can take that as the important point when you use normalization. Then I want to go into this topic, but you should know that it is connected. It's very important to know that the main theorem of elimination theory, Hilbert's null Schlenzarts, and the so-called density theorem, density of Zariski open sets. These three are actually equivalent. Noether didn't show it, But if you see books of, say, Mumford, complex algebraic varieties, then they actually, you can make out, and you can see a paper by Tate, they know what it says is equivalent, but now we all know it's equivalent. So these papers really prove the steps to say they are all equivalent. So these three very important properties are all equivalent to the Noether normalization. They're all equivalent, and the proof is by using Noether normalization. You can prove each of them separately by Noether normalization, but you can also prove their equivalence. Part of it, the Noether normalization comes in the picture. Let me skip this. This also I will skip. So one of the things in classical geometry was to find a non-trivial birational correspondence between projective varieties. For example, if you project from a smooth point outside, then you get a birational correspondence from an irreducible quadric to projective space. Okay, so that was the nice thing, was to take a space and then you try to project it and see whether you get a better known space. And there's something called linear systems which were used to do this. Noether's normalization showed that the linear systems are finite dimensional. So one could do it in a very effective manner due to this theorem of Noether. And the other important thing which all the geometers use is Grothendieck generic flatness. And again, I will not go into it, but I want to just keep it in mind. I'll keep the slides, so you can always look at it at some time. It'll be put up, I'm sure. Okay, so that is a very important generic flatness lemma. And using generic flatness, you can prove that the fiber dimension is upper subject semi-continuous. And these things are always used by the geometers whenever they study objects. These are two important applications of Noether normalization. Okay. Now, let me change topics. I have now done with Erlangen, but I shall be going to Göttingen. I have very little time. Okay. So I like to begin in a historical way, because Noether also seemed to look at it from a historical angle and then connect things. So quadratic reciprocity law, theorem of Gauss, which he found at the age of 19, actually gave a proof. The theorem was already expected by others like Euler and Alexander. And then I won't tell you details about it, but let me say that this is what really started number theory in a essential way. And even today, everything which has comes from knowing about reciprocity laws. Then you have the law of cubic reciprocity, then you have a biquadratic reciprocity law. All this Gauss actually got, but he never wrote a proof for the biquadratic. But because he wanted to get these laws, he decided that he cannot just work with integers. The problem is number theoretic, but you cannot work with integers. You have to add more numbers. He put in ZI, which is now known as the ring of Gaussian integers. And working in ZI, or he also worked in Z omega, or the cubic case, where omega is a primitive cube root of unity. Working with these rings, he was able to prove those results. So that attracted the attention of many people, that, oh, he's taking different rings now and working over them, and then able to come back, okay? So he basically showed that these rings, ZI, Z omega, these rings are the unique factorization rings. You can decompose a prime into unique way as product of, even a number in this ring as a product of primes. Now, idea of Gauss was used by others, other giants. Euler, Dirichlet, Lemur, all of them did it. And they tried to prove study the unique factorization in these rings, Z eta, where eta is a primitive nth root of unity. Okay. The theory of algebraic numbers grew out of these attempts. And the attempt was to solve Fermat. There was an equation of Fermat, and people wanted to say that Fermi is true and there is no solutions if n is bigger than 2. X raised to n plus y raised to n equal to z raised to n. Just to do that, we try to work with different rings. They didn't call it rings, the rings of algebraic numbers. So Kummer worked with this ring. He took elements of this type. This comes from the equation for the nth root. X raised to n equal to 1. If you factorize it, then you get one term which looks something like this. He assumed it's a unique factorization. Somehow he did not think it was not, and therefore claimed Fermat. But Dirichlet pointed out a mistake. Similarly, Cauchy and Lamy had made similar mistakes, though different rings. Later on, it was shown that for n equal to 23, this is the smallest case of which z eta is not a unique factorization domain. But one has to restore unique factorization somehow. So Kummer created a theory of ideal numbers. It should be ideal numbers. And I want to go into what are ideal numbers. And he got some unique factorization in these rings, from which he's able to establish Fermat. And actually, his student continued his work, and till n equal to 256, they could establish it. But Dedekind, who was a school teacher and a student of Gauss, thought of the problem in a totally different way. He realized that taking an element and proving it is having a factorization is not so easy. Always, when you probably work with it, you realize you should not take an element, but you should take multiples of that element. You have got an A in a ring. It's an element. But if you take multiples of that element, this is a set. This set is closed under addition. And if any element is in the ring, and I is an element in the ideal, then R times I is also in the ideal. Today we call this type of objects principal ideals, the ideal generated by the element A. Okay, so this is how the ideal theory started. In fact, Dedekind had 4 versions of ideal theory. He gave 4 versions about ideal theory. And they are all different. So he had a series of papers, 1871, 1876, 77, 1879, 1894. Basically, he introduced algebraic integers and the concept of a number field, the concept of a ring of numbers, the concept of an ideal in a ring of numbers. So he had the idea of an ideal also, but he always thought of it in a ring of numbers. Emmy Noether was very influenced by the work of Dedekind. And she always says that his ideas is what she's talking about. Okay? It's so strange, you know, but sometimes the person speaks something, tells something, and he himself doesn't realize how powerful his ideas are. I had a similar experience with Amit Roy. I told him my thesis is entirely your thoughts. He said, I don't know what you're talking about. I said, whatever you said, I just took it in general context. I thought you were saying that. And I did it. But he never accepted it. He said, no, I didn't think of it that way. It's something quite common that you, when you're working on a problem, you become more involved in the problem per se, and rather than the general context of what you're doing. So she realized it after many years, 30 years later. She has taken the work of Dedekind, understood it properly, and then she has put it in the proper framework. But as usual, it is not just Dedekind's work, it's also the work of Kummer's student, Kronecker, who had put the idea of adjoining a root. Okay, so this is a root, you adjoin and form a new field from that. So Steinitz also talked about it. And then there's a third thing which influenced her, that was more recent, that was Lasker. Lasker was a chess player, but he also was interested in mathematics. And he realized that you can get some type of unique factorization for ideals. So he got this notion of what is called primary ideals. He wrote about primary ideals, and he talked about a decomposition of an ideal. Decomposition means it's an intersection of primary ideals. And he did that in the polynomial ring, kx on xn. So again, he took a ring. In that ring, he thought about the ideals, and in that, he showed the primary decomposition. So he defined the concept of primary, but his definition is different from that of Emmy Noether. And he used heavy elimination theory and geometry to prove this factorization property. It was completely, anybody else think that these are all very different things. They're not the same thing. But she took these three things into account, and then she thought about Steinitz and ring theory fundamentals, which she later on did. And then she reformulated theorems of Dedekind and Lasker completely. And this was the beginning of the development. So I will tell you a little more about it. So she introduced the concept of a ring, an ideal, and a module over the ring, and formalized how one can play with ideals, addition, intersection, modules, direct sum products, etc. And then she began her work on defining, not only in commutative rings, but also in non-commutative rings, the theory of left ideals, right ideals, with Schmeidler. And then she published her landmark paper in ideal theory in ring, in which using the ACC, the ascending chain condition, which really she recognized as the key, which had a lot of power, she did so many things. She did the entire, she did everything. She did the ACC she recognized as important to prove Hilbert's theorem. Hilbert had proved that every ideal in a polynomial ring is finitely generated. She also proved the Dedekind's rings, about the factorization in the Dedekind rings. She also did the Lasker's theory of primary ideals for rings, having ACC. And all these proofs are so easy today. Okay, all these proofs she did. She's also shown this, what we sometimes call Cohen's property. I don't know why. It was, I mean, this paper, it is there, the descending chain condition on prime ideals. So Dedekind's papers, she studied more extensively in three papers, actually. And she absolutely characterized those rings, those algebraic rings, for which you can say that there is a unique factorization. Okay, but this is exactly my first half, or my second half of my second semester course in algebra in TIPR, what I told you so far. It's essentially that. Okay, so when I teach commutative algebra, I used to earlier only teach about Noether and Krull's work. Noether normalization, its application to geometry, primary decomposition, Krull's work. Krull had a lot of work on primary decomposition, which I also taught. Various things like that. Dedekind domains, number rings, Japanese rings, so there's some finiteness property, Japanese rings, completions, which come little by Krull, more by Krull than by Noether. The Krull intersection theorem comes there. And then in the first half, the last part of the first year course is usually on character theory of groups, representation theory of groups. And then I continue with that and discuss representation theory of groups, and I discuss quadratic forms and various things about that leading up to the Hasse-Noether theorem. Sometimes I have been able to even prove the Hasse-Brauer-Noether theorem in the class. Okay? So today we have slightly changed. There are some changes which have taken place. Instead of working more on the ideals and primary Noetherian rings, one talks about dimension theory more, because that is possible now, and also study the regular local rings. How can one do so much more, you would say, than what you were doing earlier? The reason is, the shift is due to the work of hindsight of Kaplansky. He brought in more forcibly the localization techniques. There's something called localization, which is nothing but saying that instead of taking all the quotient field always, why don't you just take A upon B? I gave you an example of a ring at a point on a variety, A upon B, where B is not equal to 0, and take all these type of elements, and then you take rings, sub-rings of the quotient field, and work with those rings. That is a very powerful tool, actually, and that has helped a lot to simplify many of the proofs. You don't need the primary primary ideals, you only need associated primes, which are easier to refine than primary ideals. And this localization technique actually began in the work of a student of Noether, Heinrich Krell. I don't think he's known for anything else, but he did this. And then it got further maturity in the work of Chevalley and Uskov. Uskov is a Russian. He may have been influenced by Emmy Noether's frequent visit to Moscow. I'm not sure of that. So this is the sort of course we do in the second semester. This is half the course. The last part is now what I'm going to enter. So how much time do I have? Because earlier I said if I don't have time, then I'll just leave the notes. Huh?
Sorry, we didn't start.
Probably 10 more minutes.
10 more minutes, okay. So I won't go into this now. This is something more about Dedekind's work. I'll only say that there are three papers which she wrote about it, and in one of them she defines the separable algebra. You will see that. The separable algebras are defined here. And this was sort of the beginning of Galois theory of rings. But she's not acknowledged as much in that because she only did this. Then the tensor product was defined of algebras, was defined for the first time by Emmy Noether in the third paper. Okay? When I checked the 1950 paper, 1960 paper of Auslander and Buxbaum, Auslander did not know about Emmy Noether's work. Somebody had pointed it out to him, the work which appeared. This was the work which appeared posthumously in 1950. Somebody had told him about it, and so he just mentions it that I came to know about this. So he was also doing the development of Galois theory for rings. So he did not even know about Emmy Noether's work 10 years later. The physicist did not know it at all. You know, they never referred to her work. In fact, you mentioned the books. If you look at the textbooks of physics, only one or two of them mention Noether. The rest don't. This has been recorded somewhere. I forget which are the ones which have it. So this is the main impact of Emmy Noether in non-commutative algebra. These are the two papers which are the main impact. So let me just say that there were two or three theories. See, people work with matrices. There's something called Mashke. There is, I will write it as Dedekind. Have I written it here as Dedekind? Yeah. So Dedekind's group determinant. Frobenius' idea on that. And was there one more? Yeah. Okay. These two results. Now this is something to do with a group of matrices. So representation theory had the idea that if you take homomorphisms of a group into the linear, let us say C, those days it was all C, and study these matrices instead and their properties, and study various representations, then you can get back good information about group G. Okay, so I should add that one such theorem. So one of the theorem was Mashke, who said that if you have a representation in which all the matrices looked like this. Block, 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 zero. That's big blocks. But there is a non-trivial, non-diagonal block. Then you can actually have things all looking like this in a different way. Okay, this was very important, actually, this theorem of Mashke. Then Dedekind had a strange idea. His idea was, if you have a group, G, with this you associate a matrix. So for elements of the group, say the identity, say I call it X1, and then for G, I call it XG. Right? So you have to associate the matrix X, GI, GJ inverse. This is the matrix. This is the group determinant matrix of Dedekind. And you look at its determinant. For several matrices, like the circulants I mentioned, this determinant can be written as a product of linear factors. So Dedekind had the idea that, is it possible always or not? And he was trying various examples, and he realized it's not possible. So for 10 years, he got nothing, but he did various cases, and one day he decided to send it to Frobenius in a letter saying, how do you calculate? His idea was that I'm doing it over C. Why don't you do it over quaternions? Go to a slightly different algebra and work over that, and maybe you can get the factorization into linear terms. The idea was always to use a higher algebra and then use that to get the idea of how to do it. But Frobenius did not think about what Dedekind asked. He decided to find out what are the irreducible factors. And he managed to get all the irreducible factors of this determinant. Bernstein's theorem is of an entirely different type. Using ideas of Mashke and otherwise, we can say that he proved the following. If you have got a group which has only two prime divisors, powers of two primes, these two are primes, then such a group is solvable. Solvable is something like saying, if you look at the Galois group with that equation, those equations can be solved. Okay, in some sense, it's a way that the polynomials associated are solved, can be solved. So that is what Bernstein's theorem was. So they look quite different. This is something else, this is something else. She put it in one framework. She said, you should not be thinking of linear algebra as matrices. You should be thinking of it as modules, okay? And you should be thinking of it as, modules, and it was possible to do that if you assumed the good old ACC and DCC were used now. By this time, DCC had also developed with the work of Artin, okay? And the idea of group with operators had also developed in the work of Krull and Schmidt, where they got the decomposition for the groups of groups with operators. So she could use these things and herself put all these three theorems in the context of module theory and how the modules decompose and how they behave. That she completely changed the way of thinking in representation theory. Okay, I won't go into the details of that. She did several things. Okay. She, example, even extended results of Wedderburn, the way Artin had done it, and also some results of Dixon. And she completely changed the way how people looked at it. So Hermann Weyl says that she did representation theory in the proper way, essentially, and changed the subject of representation theory. But her work, which was talked about, I'll end with that, her work, which was talked about by Professor Khanduja, is something to do of the following type. See, like Dedekind said, go from C to quaternions. Right? Now, the center of quaternions is C. And moreover, you can say that this is a division ring or field, or what is it called? A field. I call it a division field. every non-zero as a unit there. So one can say, but there are no more further you cannot do. If you have the octonions, they no longer are that good. This type of problems were also being considered around that time. So one can ask the question, what kind of objects you should consider to study? What kind of algebras you should consider to study over C, which can give you back information about C? Because after all, we had already seen that if you go from Z to C or even ZI, it already gave more information, and that could be pulled on to Z. So the same way here also the study started, how can I get more information? So one thing which Wedderburn's theorem said is that the rings which are no two-sided ideals, they will look like M and D, that D is a division ring. A division, this is an example, Q. And similarly to Q, you can always think of QAB. You know, I square equal to J square equal to K square equal to minus 1 will now change to I square equal to A, J square equal to B. And case K is IJ. You can write down the equations, and you get another algebra here by using these relations, which is called the quaternion algebra with respect to AB. And one can show that QAB is isomorphic to the matrix ring over some division ring, if and only if there is an equation has no non-zero solutions, has no solutions. It turns out that this equation was what was being studied, what was studied by Legendre, and that equation was really what was required in Gauss' reciprocity law. So the whole study of algebras became a study of reciprocity laws, okay? And these were some nice example of algebras where they first came in. Then they came in the other way, which was told again by Professor Khanduja, and that is the cyclic algebra. So if you have an extension and say the Galois group is G, which is cyclic, then you can use L and G and form the cyclic algebra. That's what she showed the other day. So this was due to Dixon. Dixon was influenced by the ideas of Schur, who had already started showing these things. And both Brouwer and Noether were influenced by the ideas of Schur, especially Brouwer, and they came up with cross product. So this generalizes this concept, and you can take any G, L over K, G, any G, and you can form the cross product. So that's a cross product algebra. So let us just say CLG. This was with the special case I am talking about is due to Noether. So Noether's contribution was the cross product. Brouwer had a much more complicated method. So they introduced what are known as factor sets. And they showed that so if you call this algebra with center to be the base thing, a central simple algebra. They realized that a central simple algebra can be easily studied because both Brouwer and Noether independently realized it, and then they wrote a joint paper that you can always take a central simple algebra, and there is inside that a field K called a splitting field, such that C tensor A is a matrix. Okay, this is a division algebra. This gave them a lot of power actually. And you can also get a Galois splitting field. Now because the Galois comes in, one can always think about the cross products with respect to that. And what they showed is all central simple algebras are really cross product algebras. This together with that Hasse local global principle enabled one to get the complete picture for local class field theory. That is all the Dixon's conjecture. All the algebras, central simple algebras, over a local field are cyclic algebras. So in some sense, and this is a very important theorem which has huge development. The entire class field theory was used when you saw the proof of Andrew Wiles. So class field theory was used. In fact, the first proof of Wiles had a mistake, a gap. And that gap was, he forgot that whenever you have reciprocity laws, some commutative algebra is needed. And it was those rings, complete intersection rings, that to be shown to be Gorenstein, which was done by Richard Taylor. And then that commutative algebra came in the picture, which has always been in the picture in the background whenever you have reciprocity laws. That ended that famous theorem of Wiles. Okay, I think I don't want to, I have told these things in a different way, but that's okay. I only end with the ICM talk. Okay, in 1932 in Zurich, he was honored by being asked to, the first person and last person, I think, who didn't have a job and sort of still gave an ICM talk, invited talk. And here she started something different, okay? She initiated the idea of using non-commutative algebras to the theory of central simple, and the theory, especially the theory of central, to commutative algebra. So non-commutative and commutative seem very different, and she sort of initiated that idea. And she showed how Galois theory can be derived in that way. And as you, I told you, she talked about separable algebras earlier. So those ideas could be used to later on by others, like Auslander and others, to develop a Galois theory for rings. Okay. Hasse and Chevalier applied these methods to class field theory also. So she gave the extension of Galois theory. And she also gave the cross product theory. And she used all that and also derived a different way which we now teach of Hilbert's theorem 90, a very famous theorem of Hilbert. And in this, she used the Skolem-Noether theorem and the cross product. Her proof is not probably the best way to do it now, but it certainly is a very interesting way of idea of doing things. Finally, Jacobson observed that in her method, the connecting homomorphism, which comes between the homology groups, appeared for the first time. So the tensor product appeared, the connecting homomorphism appeared, and many other beautiful things appeared. Sorry for the long talk. Thank you for the attention. I hope they got an idea that she has done fantastic work. Her work is quite revolutionary.